university level have dealt with MOOC course design and operations. And we also considered how the MOOC platforms in the region, Asia-Pacific regions, are working to make their portal or platform more teacher and learner friendly and effective. Today, this session will address the major developments and prospects for MOOCs at universities in Asia-Pacific regions. You can look at the university's strategy and policies towards the MOOC in a comparative perspective. So this session aims to draw the practical implications for further development of MOOCs from the university level in Asia-Pacific regions by bringing in and share the advanced practice of MOOCs at the university level in the regions. More specifically, in terms of institutional level, this session will look at the current status of MOOCs, the obstacles facing universities in developing, operating, and promoting MOOCs in their campuses and local communities, and their efforts to overcome the obstacles. So today, we have four speakers from Asia-Pacific regions. The first is Professor Dr. Seung-Yoon Oh, professor at the University of Science and Technology, Republic of Korea. And the second speaker is Professor Dr. Kristanti Ambar Puspitasari, at the Universitas Terbuka from Indonesia. And the third one is Professor Dr. Vilas Wuwongse, right? Yes, professor at Mahidol University, Kingdom of Thailand. The last speaker is Mr. Masanobu Obinata, director at the Bureau of Academic Research and Information, Sophia University in Japan. So let us introduce the first speaker, the Professor Dr. Seung-Yoon Oh. Yes, give a applause to him. Yes.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Sir. Don't worry about my presentation. I have everything here. Annyeonghaseyo. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Seung-Yoon Oh from Korea. And this morning, I'm going to talk about MOOCs at two different universities, one POSTEC and the other UST. Why two universities? Here's the reason. Can you turn it over for me, please? Yes. This is a brief intro of myself. As you can see here, I have a little background. I have an Air Force background. I used to be a pilot, and I flew aircraft. And I went to Yonsei University and Florida State. And until last November, I was a vice director of Center for Excellence in Education at POSTEC. And on the first day of December, I moved to UST. That's why I'm talking about two different universities. Okay, MOOCs at POSTEC. Can you? All right. Thank you. POSTEC stands for Pohang University of Science and Technology. It was founded 30 years ago. And the conceptual image of POSTEC is small but strong, a research-focused university. It has about 3,500 students, and the student-faculty ratio is about 6-1. And it has 12 departments and three professional graduate schools. POSTEC is actively participating in MOOCs, as Dr. Im mentioned. Specifically for K-MOOC and Coursera. The SKP MOOC in the middle of them is actually a subdivision of K-MOOC. I'm going to explain about that a little later. POSTEC, the purposes of POSTEC's participation in MOOC are can be three, I think. First one is contribution to society, and second one is providing a wide range of learning opportunity to the students. And third is internal innovation in education. Okay, I need this actually. In year 2015, the POSTEC was one of the first K-MOOC university and offered two courses. One in mechanical engineering area, and the other one is electronic engineering. The target audience of these course was graduate students or upper level undergraduate students. So we got feedback from some students, and they told us the courses were too difficult. In year 2016, last year, POSTEC was developing 10 courses, 3 K-MOOC courses by itself, and 5 courses of fun series here in collaboration with Seoul National University. K, Korea Advanced Institute for Science and Technology, in short, KAIST. The purpose of these courses were to popularize the science and technology to people. And at the end of year 2015, POSTEC signed on an agreement with Coursera and developing two courses, one in ferrous technology and the other one about science and technology in Silla Dynasty. Silla Dynasty is the first unified dynasty in Korean Peninsula about 1,200 years ago. Okay, this is really nice. Yeah, selection criteria for the lecturer is for the most teaching capability. It should the instructor of the MOOC should have more than 90% positive feedback from the students, and the criteria for the course is are actually two. One, it should represent the post-tech education, and the other one is good to popularize the science and technology to the general ordinary people. Feedbacks, unfortunately, we didn't have enough data to analyze the feedback from the students because there were very limited number of successful completion. As I mentioned before, the course was too difficult. And some courses being offered in 2016 is still in progress. Okay, institutional support. POSTEC recognize any MOOC certification as academic credits. This is revolutionary strategy to promote MOOC in the campus, and the university supports certification fee for students about half of the full certification fees. In the near future, POSTEC is going to open a MOOC-based degree program in computer science area, and I believe Dr. Im is actually actively working on it. Am I right? Yeah. Okay, this is about the MOOCs at POSTEC, and now I'm going to talk about MOOCs at UST, where I'm currently being employed. UST stands for University of Science and Technology in Korea, and it was founded about 13 years ago by 32 national research institutes. This university is a graduate-only university, and very similar to Shokendai in Japan and UCAS in China. We have 1,300 students, and surprisingly, 1,600 faculty members. Those faculty members are actually help researchers in National Research Institute and help faculty members to teach students. We have 32 campuses throughout Korea and 66 subdivided majors. As you can see on the map, we have 32 campuses and about 20 are in Daejeon area, which is in the middle of Korea. And my the UST, headquarter of the UST is in Daejeon area too. Okay, last year, UST hired me as a MOOC specialist. Can you believe that? Well, the proposal to participate in UST is actually actively trying to participate in MOOC, and the proposals are these: to share up-to-date research outcomes for academia and business. And second one is to decrease the teaching burden of the faculty members. As I mentioned before, because they are half researchers and half faculty members. And the third purpose is to increase the name recognition. In other words, increase the visibility of the university. And this is all about offering MOOCs. And, on the other hand, we are actively trying to adopt and utilize MOOCs outside of the university. The goals are, so one, providing more courses, which is currently currently limited due to the scattered campuses, and we also going to provide a remedial course for those who are not completely ready for the regular curriculum. This year, we are currently developing two courses for KMOOC. One in UST KIMM KIM campus. KIM stands for Korea Institute of Machinery and Material Science, and the one from UST KASI. KASI stands for Korea Astronomy and Space Science Institute. The selection criteria for the lecturer is the same as that of POSTEC, and the criteria for course is the course should have high practicality with up-to-date research outcomes for both academia and business. Okay, UST also supports certification fees for the students. And as you can see at the bottom of this slide, I myself currently conducting a research and development project to provide MOOC-based individualized remedies program. We accept more than 300 newcomers each year from more than 100 universities. And due to that, there are many individual differences among the students, and it makes difficult for the regular curriculum. It makes the operation of regular curriculum difficult, and some of the students are not completely ready for the regular curriculum. So in this system, we're going to diagnose the academic level of the newcomers and compare the result with the preset prerequisites for each 66 subdivided majors. When the answer is yes, then the situation is happy. But when the answer is no, then the system will choose a list of MOOCs and recommend it to the individual students to fill the gap of that students. To do this, we're going to develop a list of recommended MOOCs for each 66 subdivided majors. Okay, I think this is all I have for today. And thank you for your attention. 감사합니다.
very organized presentations. Actually, I give the speakers three questions, and then he organized his presentation according to the three recommended points. And next, the professor, Dr. Kristanti Ambar Puspitasari. Yes, let's give a warm welcome to her.
Good morning, everyone. I'm honored to be here. I'm Kristanti Ambar Puspitasari from Universitas Terbuka, from the Research Institute at Universitas Terbuka. I'm representing UTE. We call it UTE, not UT. To talk about, to share experiences about the implementation, the development implementation, and also sustaining the MOOC at our university. Well, UTE was established 32 years ago with probably I should sit down. With the mission to widen quality education, higher education to the people of Indonesia, because at that time we at that time Indonesia still have very low gross participation index in education, especially in higher education, and the government thought that this is the solution for Indonesia to provide open university. And not only that, in 2015 even with 250 million people, we only have 25% of the population went to higher education. So it's very, very low in participation in higher education. And that's why UTE also offer continuing education programs to Indonesia, aside from providing or offering degree programs. So with the, At that time, we only offer a very traditional open university with the learning course materials printed solely, not with the, but with media like CD, and it's a long time in the. With the emergence of the internet and the ICT, we then try to offer a tutorial, online tutorial for our students. It started in 2005 after several years of trying out. I think the internet emerged in 2014, 35% still the internet users in Indonesia, and mostly they resided in the island of Java, where the Jakarta, the capital city, is located. But see that there is an increasing participation rate, penetration internet in Indonesia, starting from the year of 2000, around 5%, then goes up to 35% last year. So in 2014, we decided to offer the very first online program for master degree. And the next year, we offer online program for the bachelor degree. And the the internet penetration, the improvement of internet penetration in Indonesia, we think this is the opportunity for Universitas Terbuka to serve the country, to open up or to widen the lifelong learning, to promote the lifelong learning for the society. So we open MOOCs as continuation. Aside, we still offer the face-to-face continuing education to the society, but we also provide or offer the MOOCs here. It is a free online courses for anyone who have internet access, of course, and it is CMOOCs, and we started with 5 courses. And each faculty, we have 5 faculties in Indonesia, actually 4 faculty and 1 master program. They decided which courses to be offered. So the courses, the MOOCs here is part of the courses, just specific topics for general interest. We, at first, we have 3,500 participants, and we are not that lucky, not you who have attracted thousands, hundreds of thousands of participants. But in Indonesia, at UT, we can only attract more than 3,000 participants at that time, with the completion rate 12%. And right now, we are offering 7 courses of MOOCs, and we, learning from the past experience, we started to have promotion in digital marketing, like in Facebook, posting in Facebook, Twitter, Google Plus, LinkedIn, and our own website. And this is still in the general interest non-credit courses. And we still pick or choose specific topics of regular courses to be offered. Well, why we do that? Because we also want to let people know about our courses. So if they can experience MOOCs, then probably they can, they are willing to continue their study at UT, because as we, the government also encouraged the other university to provide online education or online programs, because the gross participation index is still very low. It's 25%, now it's about 28%, and even the people who it's 18 to 24 is even low, the participation rate in higher education. And we have 1,200 participants as of February 2017, with the completion rate of 11%. This is last year, the second semester of last year. Actually, at the first time, we offer the MOOCs with 2.8, but now we already moved to 3.2 thing. You can see here that we offer 7 courses: public speaking, food processing, distance education, marketing, parenting, introduction to Moodle, and ASEAN studies. So the courses that part of the MOOCs that part of the is public speaking, and then food processing, parenting and marketing. Distance education, we need to provide MOOCs on distance education, because most people in Indonesia doesn't know what is distance education. And so it's our obligation to educate the public to know about distance by providing MOOC. And also the introduction to Moodle, it actually we want to educate our tutors, online tutors, about how to become online tutors by familiarize them with the Moodle, introduction to Moodle. But many people also want to study about introduction to Moodle. And the ASEAN studies here, actually, it's part of the course that the to be master in Asian studies with the OU5, Open 5 Open University in ASEAN, which is UT, UPOU, OUM, Hanoi Open University, and also Sukhothai STOU. And this is just one credit hours to be offered as MOOCs. And completion rate is low, but we want to improve our MOOCs because we don't know. The completion rate is low because they don't want to have the certificate, or the course is boring, or they didn't get what they expect when they enroll, or they just want to enroll as a general interest. They don't need the certificate. So we need to know about that. And we then studied the profile of the student. And it is surprising that we can see here that the internet users in Indonesia, the biggest number is it's 25. But the participants of our MOOCs is the biggest number is 18 to 24. This is the gender, a bit different. And we do the survey. We did a survey last year, and we got the results that many of our participants are high schoolers. They have high school diploma, and then they came from the private sector employee, and they have their own home internet access, and they also know UTE MOOCs in our websites. So we learned that we are not so popular in Medsos here, only 7%. And they enroll a MOOC the very first time at UT. And they want to enrich their knowledge. That's the reason why they are enrolling at MOOCs. And then that they get what they, but we have to be very careful because we have here 26% who didn't get what they expect when they join the MOOC, and also 24% here they don't want to take another MOOC in the future. So we have to learn more about this person, why that's the weakness of our MOOC, and how can we improve our MOOCs? And 87% of the participants would like to continue their degree at Universitas Terbuka if it were credited. As I mentioned before, we only offer it as non-credit MOOCs. So here are the six MOOCs provider in Indonesia that is free, open for the public. We don't have like Indonesian MOOC, like Thai MOOC or Korean MOOC. We are not that lucky yet. Here, UT also collaborate with Indonesian X, which is the biggest provider of MOOCs in Indonesia. They have collaborate with major university in Indonesia, and UT only have one course join with them. And this is what is interesting. Public speaking is the only one course that we offer in Indonesian access, which also in our MOOCs, and it can attract much more students here, much more participants, 7,000, 6,000. But in our only MOOC, we can only attract 200 people. So this is, we collaborate with UNESCO too for the promotion of Asian studies. And as the challenges and difficulties, we know that not all courses attract many people, and many participants, so we need to know more about that, why it's happening. We need to do some kind of survey, especially to those who didn't want to enroll anymore, to know what needs to be done. And there are wide variation in terms of age, level of education, and also prior knowledge. And that's why probably the participants did not engage very actively in the discussion. And probably the participants also prefer more video lecture like the Indonesian X offered rather than in our online, like online learning. And then it's too time consuming too for tutor mark assignments like essay test and portfolio. And we need to learn more about how to mark essay test and portfolio aside from the tutor. And not very popular in social media, that's why Indonesia X, they have very big promotion. For example, every end of semester, they give the certificate at the mall, a very big mall, and they invited the big media there. So it's very, very big promotion. Everyone in the shopping mall know, and they got television media. And for future plan, because of the challenges last year from the faculty, the MOOCs then coordinated by the Research Institute. And so last month, January, we with the faculty sat together and we decided that we should offer more courses that meet the needs of the participants, the society, which in our case is young adults. So probably we can offer more courses that meet their expectation, like probably entrepreneurship for beginners, programmers for beginners, and English for beginners, child psychology, and other courses that probably can be transferable to UT. But we still also have to offer general interest courses too. And that's why we need to collaborate with professionals and reputable practitioners that are good at offering the general interest courses. And we definitely need to improve our learning strategies so that students can participate more in the providing feedback to each other to self-evaluate their learning experience probably. And we need to incorporate more computer mark assignments and also increase promotion in social media. Actually, we already incorporate learning analytics to our regular courses, but not yet in the MOOC. But if we do want to give credit to the MOOCs, then we have to pay more attention to what the student is learning and how we can improve the instruction. I think that's I can present today, I can share with you, and I would appreciate very much if there is any suggestion or comments. Thank you.
Yes, thank you for systemic presentations containing many useful information about MOOCs at the institutional levels. And next is the Professor Dr. Vilas. I think he is one of the leading MOOC advocates in Thailand, right? Yes. So let's give a warm welcome to Dr. Vilas. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Actually, I wish to join this workshop yesterday, but I could not because at my university, we are actually conducting a workshop on the MOOC training for our faculty members and staff. So this week and the next 2 weeks, we will spend time to actually train our faculty and staff to produce MOOCs. So I would like to start my presentation by giving probably a brief introduction to Mahidol University. Okay. Okay. So this is sort of overview of our campus in Salaya, and we have the motto that you, Mahidol uses, the wisdom of the land of Thailand. And so a brief history, Mahidol University was established as the medical school in 1888. So this year will be 129 years old. Next year will be a big celebration for our university, 130 years old. And the present name, Mahidol University, was granted by King Bhumibol in 1969. So since the history of university is based on medical science, so we're still very strong in medical science. We have major campuses. The major one will be located in Bangkok and the surrounding area. Actually, in Bangkok, we have three campuses. The undergraduate program will be in Nakhon Pathom, south of Bangkok, but we also have the old campus in the center of Bangkok in Lama 6 Road, okay, and then which actually has also hospitals. If you look at the our academic program, you see the yellow one in clinical, preclinical, and health related programs. And if you combine with life science, so we'll be over half or 50% of our programs will be related to medical science, health related, and then life science. Okay, and the less is less than that. And right now we have about over 30 faculty in student colleges, a little bit too much. And then also 600 study programs, both undergraduate and graduate programs. And so total number of students is over 30,000, the major of which is still undergraduate. We aim to be research-oriented university. So in the future, probably we're going to fix the number of undergraduate students and try to increase the number of postgraduate students. Faculty member is close to 4,000 faculty members. So the ratio is about 10 students or 9 students per one faculty member. It's not that bad. Regarding the budget, is probably one of the universities that have a large amount of the budget. So in total, in the last year, we have about 50 billion baht. So that would be about 1.4 billion US dollar. Okay, and 70% of which actually come from operating, generate income, because university has two largest hospitals. Okay, one is called Silan Hospital, has over 2,000 beds, and the other one is Lama Tipiti Hospital, is over 1,000 beds. And so about only, if you look at only about 30% we receive from the national government. Okay, about 70% is from our own generated income. Okay, and then you may ask why MOOCs at Mahidol University. Actually, it started just a year ago. And the reason why we have this, because we have actually the current administration team has decided on 4 strategies. Okay, excellence in 4 areas. One, of course, in research. And the second one, which related to MOOCs, is excellence in outcome-based education for globally competent graduates. And because of this strategy, so lead to the development or employment of MOOCs. Okay, and it's also part of a strategy that we want to produce our graduates, which have 4 characteristics. First is the T-shape graduates, meaning that our graduates should have the breadth and also the depth knowledge as well, and to be socially contributing. Okay, so it's not only for their own sake, but they should also help the society as well. And the third one is to be entrepreneurial-minded. So it's not making money, but to try to actually solve new problems, right? When you encounter new problems, then find new solutions. And the last one is globally talented. So this will be sort of the guideline for our MOOCs activity. Okay, and in addition to that, not only students, but we also wish actually to do sort of three major transformation, teacher transformation, teaching transformation, and then technology transformation. And the last one actually is very easy, but the most difficult one is the top one, teacher transformation, based on our experience, 2 years experience. And so based on this strategy, then we actually have started these MOOC and also these SPOC activities. It actually started around the end of 2015. Okay, when I was requested to join the university and to lead these MOOC activities. So how are we to do that? So all faculty members are encouraged to create MOOCs or SPOCs, not only MOOCs but SPOCs. But actually, we start with SPOCs first to be internally used within the university. Okay, and how we're going to encourage? So we have to provide support for our faculty members, and there are three types of support that we actually are providing to our faculty members. The first one is the establishment of what I call EdTech unit. We start with the informal unit. So a new position for assistant president was established in December 2015. And then we have five staff members within this unit. And it's going to be expand. We are going to hopefully the council will approve the increase of the number of supporting staff from five to eight members. And the second one is provide financial support or incentive, both in cash and then in kind. So I'm not sure whether I should give the exact number or not, but it's less than what TCU is giving to the Thai faculty members. It's about half of that. So for each faculty member who create MOOCs, they will be given some financial support. But financial support alone is not enough. So we are also going to provide in-kind support as well. So once a MOOC is created, then it will be considered to be some kind of workload. So probably you know it's the same for all universities. A faculty member is normally requested to teach about two or three courses, right? And then 1 hour of lecture is equivalent to 3 hours of workload, right? So if you offer a 3 credits course that is about 45 hours of lecture, then your workload would be about 135 hours, right? And so in order to provide intensive for our faculty members to create this, so we are considering to provide some workload. If, for example, the first time you create a MOOCs for 45 hours, then you might be able to give maybe around 200 to 300 hours of workload. Okay, so that will be equivalent to teaching one course, or even more than that. Okay, so the scheme. And apart from that, we also try to provide sort of academic promotion for our faculty member. In Thai universities, in order to get promoted from lecturer to assistant professor, or from assistant professor to associate professor, you have to provide two sets of outcome. One is teaching materials, and the other one is research papers. So we are going to consider MOOC as a kind of teaching material, or even an e-textbook. So once MOOC is created, then there's no need for you to write a textbook or to print out your teaching materials, but you can submit this MOOC as part of the requirement for your promotion. And the second one is that you can use your research on teaching. Okay, so far, for example, if I'm in the area of computer science, if I want to get promoted to be a professor in computer science, I have to publish papers, research in computer science. Okay, but right now, if, for example, I'm going to do research in computer education, then I could use this paper in computer education for my promotion. Okay, but for full professor, it's a little bit questionable. Maybe the OHEC may not be agree. But at the rank of assistant professor or associate professor, then I could use this education research papers, okay, as part of the requirements for academic promotion. So this is some kind of the schemes that we wish to use in order to encourage our faculty members to create MOOCs, because as a matter of fact, create MOOCs require a lot of effort. Okay, and we'll show you some of the MOOCs that we have created. Okay, and based on this, the output, so we have done this for one year. Okay, and so far we have created, not yet all completed, 14 SPOCs. Okay, so there's a MOOCs that used internally. Okay, I'm sorry, 14 MOOCs for Thai MOOC. Okay, that we receive financial support from the TCU, and then we have 16 SPOCs. Okay, for our own MOOC platform, MUX. Actually, you can go to mux.mahidol.ac.th. And once you see the MUX, then you can guess that this MOOC platform employ OpenEdX. So we use OpenEdX as a platform for our MOOCs. SPOC. Okay, before I end, I just want to show you some of the SPOC that we have created. It's a course called Organic Chemistry, and it's offered right now in the middle because the second semester of Thai University starts from January and end around end of April or early May. So now it's in the middle of the course, and this offer for 1,000 students, and we start to actually offer in the flip classroom. So students will look at this course content first, and then do the exercise discussion in the classroom. So just one minute. ไปที่ไอ้ไม่ใช่วิดีโอผมวิดีโอของผมอันนี้นะครับยินโฮพรีเซนต์ไม่ใช่จะไปที่อีเมลของผมใช่อันนี้ไม่ใช่ไปที่อีเมลของผมอันนี้ไม่ที่จะไปที่ก็มีของผมในไหนเนี่ยอินบ็อกซ์ใช่มั้ยอินบ็อกซ์โอเคเSo this course actually created by our faculty members in the Faculty of Science. She has never done any MOOC before, but within after training early last year, then she was able to create this MOOC. Cup, mail ni ha. Cup, ไปที่ mail ตัวนี้ฮะไปคัดที่เมลแต่ไม่มีนั่นอยู่ I have difficulty to access the MOOC platform from here, so I have to get the file that I obtained from my colleague. ไม่มีเสียงเพียงเสียงว่าทำเต็มจอได้ไหมครับ
มีได้
Sorry, it's in Thai. We are offered this in Thai. Okay, good point. Okay, this is just a brief introduction. What I want to share with you is that she attended our workshop last year, and what she did is actually she tried to find her own technology, right? This transparent skin, right? Because teaching chemistry you have, right? You just show, it won't be able easy for you just show a slide, right? It's probably refueling, and actually the reaction from the students is very good, the response from the students is very good. Okay, I have one thousand students taking this course. Okay, we have also other course we call lab pass, about 4,000 students taking the course. But if you ask me about the experience, we still just started, as I mentioned, this is in the middle of the semester, so we will see what will be the effect of in the introduction of this MOOC. I just want to share and encourage all of you that it's possible for you, okay? She hasn't ever done any MOOC or even online e-learning course before, okay? But because of the intuition that she can do that. And I encourage her actually to offer this course for high school students, because we need actually to help our high school students. And she says, you will do that, and probably she will be able actually to stop all these cram schools or tutor schools if her course is offered free of charge to all the Thai students. Apart from just half a second, when we talk about this institutional level policy, I think that MOOC providers should not only be universities. And I wanted to share with you that even governmental organizations should also provide MOOCs as well. Particularly governmental organizations that provide services to the public, right? So that the public could also learn something from what kind of services that are being offered. And actually, I'm now having a project to create 5 MOOCs for the Excise Department. So Excise Department, department that collect the so-called sin tax, okay, taxes from alcohol, cigarette, okay, and they're going to create 5 MOOCs, which actually is part of this MOOC will be useful for the taxpayer, because then they're going to learn what sort of education, okay, requirements, okay, and apart from that, the NPO, the non-profit organization, is also could contribute to this MOOC as well. I have one involved with one organization. Can we go to TPA? Which we have Japanese colleagues here, so I want to share with you. This organization called Technology Promotion Association, TPA, which actually is established maybe close to 40 years ago in order to promote the industrial techniques, okay, to improve the industry in Thailand with the help from Japanese industry. So this is the website, but since we have a Japanese colleague here, so apart from the English website, we also have the Japanese web page as well. So hopefully that you get maybe some information about this and that. And this organization is going to provide MOOCs training, okay, for the SME, the people working in the industry. Okay. Normally, actually, they also provide trainings, courses already, but mostly face-to-face. So next step they're going to do is actually to provide the training in using these MOOCs. Okay, sorry, I used too much time, and thank you for your attention.
Yes, and due to the lack of time, the last speakers, Mr. Obinata, yes. Give a warm welcome to him, and as condensed as you can, your presentation.
Oh, hello everyone, my name is Masanobu Obinata, a staff member of Sophia University, Tokyo, Japan. It is a great honor to be given the opportunity to present here today. I would like to briefly introduce Sophia University first, then explain our achievement in JMOOC. Now let us begin. Well, the picture, the picture is our university. The first, please let me explain the overview of our Sophia University. Our university was founded by the Jesuits in 1913 in the center of Tokyo. Sophia University is a Jesuit university and is based on the teachings of the Christianity and the Catholic spirit. Sophia has been a pioneer of international education in Japan, attracting faculty and students from all over the world. We share the educational philosophy of Society of Jesus, men and women for others with others. The phrase of the appetite. Well, every year, many international students come from all over the world. Well, this is the number of students, and the international students is here, and about 10% of the all students, and two thirds of international students from Asia, East and South Asia, and moreover. Not only international students, but also local students are diverse in their backgrounds. Quite a number of them grew up overseas or have experienced living abroad. This fact contributes to create Sophia's atmosphere of cross-cultural understanding. Well, we have 8 overseas offices and 2 offices in ASEAN area, and Thailand and Cambodia. Well, so I would like to present our engagement in open education. With the growing interest in open education in Japan, we began open courseware, so-called OCW, in 2010, we have published more than 100 contents, such as video and materials of lessons or lectures of guest speakers and so on, regardless language or theme so far. After the inauguration of JMOOC, we had the first JMOOC course in March 2015, and the second course is in September 2016. Our aim of engaging in open education is to contribute to society by publishing the results of our education and research. When we joined in JMOOC, we decided if we do, we should offer courses that only Sophia University can do. Well, next, I would like to introduce the details of 2 JMOOC courses and its features. The first course is Japan in the Age of Great Voyage, History of Cultural Exchange Between Europe and Japan, Historia. Well, as a Jesuit university, we chose the connection between East and West, originating from the transmission of Christianity to Japan, as our first JMOOC lecture. There are 3 points in the lecture. One is Japan in the 16th century, in the age of warring states, was linked to European Renaissance culture. And the second is culture exchange. And the third is introduction to Christianity in Japan. Well, to make the course We use the materials of Kristanti Bunko Library and its databases in Sophia. Kristanti means early Japanese Christians in Japanese language. Well, these are the pictures of the video from the videos. This is the old maps about Japan, but there is no Hokkaido in this map. And one of the lecturers of this lecture, he is a Jesuit. And this is the old the materials from the Kristanti Bunko Library. And the second lecture is a study of Angkor Wat, an integrated study of human beings from a new perspective. Well, as the second theme, which was the restoration of Angkor Wat and human resource development, which we have been involved since 1991. We call this Sophia Mission in Cambodia. And currently from 2016, Sophia University and Apsara Authority of Cambodia are working together on the second phase of restoration project of the Western Causeway of Angkor Wat. The course was provided by the lecturers who have been involved for a long time with this project. This is also the pictures from the videos. This is Angkor Wat. And the Cambodian researchers teaches the heritage of the Cambodian students. He is the one of the lecturers of the videos. The video is recorded near the Angkor Wat heritage. So please watch the video clip of our second lecture before telling you what we did to deliver the contents to the world. So please start the video clip. Sorry, just a moment, please.
アンコールワット研究、人間を考える総合学としての新地平。
Thank you. So go back to the presentation. Yes, okay. Well, the important point is we create Japanese contents for JMOOC, but we target to both Japan and overseas as well. We have added English subtitles to all the lecture videos, as we have seen on the video clip. Also, we prepare the tests and assignments both in Japanese and in English, so that students can choose their preferred language. In addition, we made a poster both in Japanese and English. This is the quiz or assignment in upper is English, Japanese, and lower is English. We made two types of posters. One is Japanese and the other is English. Okay. Well, this table shows the number of participants and the passes of our two lectures. We used the Gakko platform to offer our lectures. And compared to the recent average rate of Gakko, though the participants of the second lecture are fewer, the completion rate is higher than the average. Through the discussion board, we confirmed that quite a few students were eagerly discussing the topic with each other. And we think this is reflecting in the high completion rate. Well, this is the result of the questionnaire taken before starting the course. We made a questionnaire both in Japanese and English so that students can choose either to answer. Well, Japan Japanese is those who chose Japanese questionnaire and answered they are living in Japan. overseas Japanese is those who chose Japanese questionnaire and answers they are living outside Japan. Japan non-Japanese is those who chose English questionnaire and answers they are living in Japan. Then overseas non-Japanese is those who chose English questionnaire and answers they are living outside Japan. This may be not an accurate figure because not all the students answer the questionnaire. However, this result tells us that various background people took the course. And overseas non-Japanese, this is the details of the figure. Many European people watched took the lecture. This is the first lecture. And then the second lecture of Uncle Watt. This is percentage of second lecture. Well, there were students of various backgrounds here as well. But compared to the first course, the number of students taking the course in English was little, unfortunately. But I would like to introduce some free descriptive answers from English questionnaire of the first lecture. Well, upper is from Chinese students and the lower is from Spanish. Well, these are the voices about the second lecture. Well, as you see, it is clear that students whose first language is not Japanese could understand and learn a lot from our lecture as the same as Japanese students did. Although the number of those students is small, we think this approach is worth continuing as a successful model of global expansion of JMOOC. Well, lastly, I will tell you two things of our future prospects as conclusion. Well, we have to continue to create new lectures for JMOOC, but first, we would like to examine usage of contents that does not depend on MOOC platform. For example, using the video contents for local education in Cambodia for the second lecture. The core theme of second lecture is to develop human resources and also conduct collaborative works in the region. So we are planning to use our second lecture videos as educational materials for developing the people who can contribute to the restoration of Angkor Wat. To begin with, we have started showing video to people visiting the overseas office in Cambodia to introduce the purpose and the activities of a Sophia mission. Secondly, we aim to keep developing contents globally that only Sophia University can create, as we are aiming to be a global hub. The budget staff in charge is not sufficient now, but we hope to create contents making full use of strength of Sophia University and to satisfy the intellectual curiosity of not only Japan, but also people around the world. So I appreciate all of you giving me an opportunity for explaining our JMOOC project. Thank you very much. Arigatou gozaimashita.
Yes, thank you for your useful presentations. Unfortunately, we have no time to ask a question to the speakers and discuss. Actually, I have prepared several questions to the speakers, but we have no time. So if you have questions, please personally ask the speakers while having lunch. So it's time to have lunch, yes? Thank you for your interest and participation in these sessions. Yes, thank you very much. Yes,
thank you very much. Thank you, Professor So, again, for your very insightful session and all the speakers. We are a little behind, so let's have a quick lunch. How about we come back at 1:20 for the final session of the day? It will be a very important session because we're going to hear about policy level of MOOC for our region, so don't miss it. See you at 1:20, and don't forget that you need to have the green coupon for lunch. And the lunch will be the same place as yesterday, so see you after this. Khop khun krap.